Hello, I hope you're doing great. I hope you and your family are enjoying God's goodness, God's faithfulness, God's grace, and God's love. Even when we go through difficult times, as we go through dark times and trying times, even during this pandemic, I pray that God's peace and God's strength and God's joy and God's companionship and God's presence in your life will sustain you and will allow you to understand how good and how great and how awesome God is, even when there is bad things in our lives, even when we go through difficult times. I pray that as we sing songs to the Lord, as we listen to God's word, I pray that God will touch you and refresh you and encourage you once again. He will deepen your faith, He will strengthen your hope, and He will expand your love.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth, early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. When I stumble into the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God of wonders beyond our galaxy.
grace, a mighty river flowing upward from a deep but empty grave. I will praise you on the mountains, I will praise you when the mountains in my way. You're the summit where my feet are. I will praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows. No less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is. In the highlands and the heartache all the same.
Several years ago, I was able to visit a company where I was invited to be the guest speaker for a seminar. During the break, I was able to talk to two employees. The first employee came to me and shared to me his life and his work and the nature of his company and even who his boss is. So he was talking about how bad the boss is and how bad the work is and how bad this company is and how he wanted to resign every day, how he wanted to quit his job. And so as I was listening, I was just allowing him to vent and to express his emotions and his hurts. After a while, another employee came. This time, it's a different story. I was shocked to hear that this second employee is sharing a lot of good things, positive things, as if these two employees are not in the same roof, are not in the same company. The second employee was telling me how good the company is, how good the boss is, how good the work is, how good everything is. It's like he's saying, it's not perfect, but I'm grateful. I have a job, I am grateful for my boss. And so as I walked away from those conversations, I realized one thing. It could be the same work, it could be the same pay, it could be the same company, it could even be the same problem or the same difficulty, it's the same company, it's the same environment. But because they have two different perspectives, they live their lives in a different way. Sometimes the key to understanding what's going on, the key to understanding our world, our God, our lives, it's really our perspective. It's really what we see that matters. When we go through pain, when we go through pressure, when we go through problems, when we go through difficulties. Both employees went through storms, went through difficulties, went through tough times. But one person came out better, but the other person came out better. It's the same with our journey of faith and our relationship with God and how we respond to whatever's going on in our lives. We come out better when we see things in a better perspective, in a different light, but we come out bitter when we see only the shadows and the shades and the dark side and the difficulties and the negative things. That is why all of us can go through the same pandemic, the same problems, the same difficulty, the same crisis. But some of us, as we trust God, will see God in a better light. We will see that God is good, God is faithful, God is merciful, and God is loving, and God cares for us despite the ugliness and the mess in the world. And so some of us will come out better. But some of us will see only the bad things and the negative things and the lack of blessing and the lack of healing and all the fallenness and the brokenness in this world. And so some of us will come out bitter. Thus, the more we know who truly God is, the better off we are in terms of dealing and coping with pain and the pressures of life. In the book of Job, suffering is a mystery that cannot be explained. In that story, we discovered how good people handle bad things, sometimes full of anger, sometimes full of mess, sometimes disturbing, but it's always full of hope, seasoned with hope. And in the end, what gets them through is not an intellectual explanation about suffering, but rather an encounter with the living God. We endure pain, not because of an explanation of why we suffer, but through an encounter with who God is. So in this portion of the story of Job, we will notice that Job wanted to speak to God. He wanted to hear from God. Throughout his conversations with his friends, he was always telling that he wanted a day in court. He wanted a day when God will explain why this suffering is happening to him. Of course, he maintains his innocence all throughout the conversations. But now he wanted an explanation from God. He wanted to hear from God. We can recall that Job was a wealthy man. He was a righteous, godly person. The Bible says he was the greatest man in the East. Camels, livestock, business, money, fame, good family, name it, he has it. But one day, it all suddenly fell apart. Like dominoes falling, he lost his livestock, he lost his business, his 10 children perished, and worst of all, he had this sickness, very painful sickness, excruciating pain. He had boils all over his body. But through all of this, Job maintained his innocence. His three friends were accusing him that he's probably hiding a secret sin that is causing all this punishment from God and all this disaster in his life. But he says, "No, I did nothing wrong." Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man, I will question you, and you make it known to me." So this is Job's encounter with God. God is speaking to him directly, but it is not what he expected. He expects God to answer his questions, but this time, God is asking Job questions. So what is God saying to Job? Today, in this portion of the story of Job, we will learn three aspects of God's speech to Job himself. And this is the first. God is saying, "I am infinitely wise, far beyond your comprehension." God seems to be asking Job, "Do you know how everything was made? And do you know how I sustain everything that I have made? Do you know how to be God? How to be the creator of the world? Do you know what it means to manage the universe?" So God speaks about the foundations of the earth and how he formed the continents and the oceans and the rising sun and the aspects of the weather and the wind and the thunder and the lightning. And then he speaks about the fascinating beauty of the cluster of the constellation of stars. And then he talks about the animals and how he provides for them. Job thinks that he would do a better job of running the world and managing the universe. He thinks that he would do better at being God than God. So God starts asking him questions about how the world works. "Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Have you commanded the morning since your days began and caused the dawn to know its place? Have you entered the storehouses of snow? Or have you seen the storehouses of the hail?" God then goes on into the specifics of the management of creation. He talks about the stars and the constellations, clouds, rain and lightning, lions, ravens, mountain goats, wild donkeys, wild ox, the ostrich, the horse, the hawk, and eagle. In other words, God seems to be telling Job, "I am infinitely wise, far beyond your comprehension." That means, if the bigness of the universe can be managed by a wise God, if everything that happens to the animals, the intricacies of the oceans and the stars and the morning and the night and the snow and the hail and the storms and the thunder and the lightning, if God can manage all of this because of his wisdom, because of his majesty and his greatness, Job's concerns are so minute and little compared to God's all-surpassing knowledge. That means we can trust God. our problems, our pressures, our pain, and our troubles, and our difficulties, they're nothing compared to how God thinks. God's ways are higher, God's plans are better, and God's wisdom is infinitely far greater than our explanations and our complaints and our attempts to grasp what suffering means. So God is telling Job, you can trust me. I'm bigger than you. I'm bigger than your pain. I'm bigger than your problems. Are you going through difficult times? Is there a burden that you are having a hard time bearing? Are you going through broken heart or pain or a sickness that has no cure? Are you going through tough times and you are about to give up? The more you understand who God is, how big and how awesome and how wise this God is, the more we are invited to trust Him, to trust that He knows what He is doing, that whatever happens in our lives, good or bad, joyful or painful, we know that God has a purpose, that God has a reason that we do not know yet, but we can trust that He is wise, He is good, that He cares for us, and He knows what He is doing. We endure pain, not because of an explanation of why we suffer, but through an encounter with who God is. Isn't that amazing? It's like we have an anchor to our soul. We have a foundation. We have our source of strength, a deep, deep source of joy and security that money cannot give, that people cannot give, that things in life cannot give. That means that when we go through the storms of life, we can smile and we can have peace and we can have confidence. Even when we do not understand, even when we do not like what is happening, we can have this deep faith that God is wise. I can trust Him. That God is good. I can hold on to Him. That God is faithful. I can cling to Him. Whatever it is that I'm going through, we can find hope and confidence that our God is bigger than our pain. So what is God saying to Job? This is the second. I am all-powerful, far greater than your capacity. It seems that God is reminding Job that nobody can stand against God, that God is all-powerful. No creature, no human being, no power in the universe can defeat Him, can overpower Him. He's all-powerful. But at the same time, He's telling Job that, hey, I can rescue you, I can help you. I can bring back whatever you lost. I can restore whatever what was broken in your life. I can heal whatever wound you are going through because I am powerful. That's how great God is. At this portion of God's speech to Job, He mentions two creatures, two powerful creatures that no one can capture, no one can defeat, no one can tame. Wild beasts. Number one is the behemoth. The second one is the Leviathan. Experts say that the behemoth probably is an ancient term for the rhinoceros, a huge beast that nobody can tame. And the Leviathan probably is a dinosaur or a big crocodile. So these are powerful beasts that can destroy any creature, any human being. But only God can tame. Only God has power over them. So it seems that God is telling Job, Job, can you tame, can you defeat a behemoth? Can you defeat or can you tame a Leviathan? Can you catch them? Can you destroy them? Can you defeat them? If you cannot defeat this huge, powerful beast, these creatures, how can you defeat me? How dare you try to come against me? So God said, can anyone capture it? No one is fierce enough to rouse it. Who then is able to stand against me? Who has a claim against me that I must pay? Everything under heaven belongs to me. So it seems God is telling Job, if you cannot stand up against a Leviathan or a behemoth, how can you stand up against me? God seems to be saying, hey, I'm powerful. I'm greater. No creature can stand up against me. So you have to humble yourself. You just have to trust that I know what I'm doing. I can do things for you on your behalf better and bigger and greater than your capacity, than your strength that can do for you. But you have to trust me. In other words, the more we understand who God is, how big and how great and how powerful He is, the more confident we become when we go through trials, when we go through problems, when we go through sickness, when we go through pain. The more we understand that our God is not small, that our God is not weak, that our God cannot be defeated by anything or by anyone, the more we can be at peace and secure that we trust a big and awesome God. God is bigger than our problems. God is stronger than any abuse that we went through. God is greater than any problem or any pain that we are carrying. God is stronger and larger and bigger than any pandemic, than any problem that we are going through as a nation, as a people, as a church, as a family, as a person. Remember during the time of Moses, he sent 12 spies to look at the land that is promised by God to them. And so they looked at the land, they spied on it, and they gave a report to Moses and to the people. 10 spies said, "Oh, there are giants in the land. There's bigger than us. There are giant walls. We cannot conquer it. We look like grasshoppers in their eyes." But 2 spies, Joshua and Caleb, said, No. God is bigger than the giants. God will give them to us. We will destroy them." You notice that the 12 spies saw the same land. They saw the same giants. They saw the same problem. They saw the same circumstance. But the 10 spies saw how big the giants are. They saw how big the problems are. But the 2 spies saw how big God is, how great God is. That the giants and the walls are nothing compared to God. That is how we overcome our difficulties. That's how we endure our pain. That's how we survive our crisis and our suffering and our problems. That's how we defeat the onslaught of the difficulties in our lives. When we see a big God, a powerful God, that is how we live our lives confident and secure that our God is a great God. We endure pain not because of an explanation of why we suffer, but through an encounter with who God is. So what is God saying to Job? This is the third. "I am perfectly just, far better than your judgment." Remember, Job's contention is, "Why is this happening to me if I am innocent?" And then he goes on accusing God that God probably committed an injustice. Probably God is doing something wrong. There is an injustice, a wrong committed against me, and God is at fault here. That is what Job seems to be saying. You see, sometimes because of the troubles that we go through, sometimes it is very tempting for us to think that can do a better job than God. We can do a better job at managing our life and running the world than God. That's a temptation that we all face, especially when we go through difficulties. When God does not answer the way we expect Him to, when God does not work the way we expect Him to, when God does not seem to carry out justice the way we expect Him to. And so we question His justice, we question His wisdom, we question His goodness. So in this part of the speech of God for Job, He seems to be saying, "Job, you have to trust me. I am a God of justice. I am a just God. You may not understand why things work this way, why I do things this way, but you have to trust that I am just, that I am good. I know how to bring justice in my terms, in my time. Would you discredit my justice? Would you condemn me to justify yourself? Do you have an arm like God's? And can your voice thunder like this? Then adorn yourself with glory and splendor, and clothe yourself in honor and majesty. Unleash the fury of your wrath. Look at all who are proud and bring them low. Look at all who are proud and humble them. Crush the wicked where they stand. Bury them all in the dust together. Shroud their faces in the grave. Then I myself will admit to you that your own right hand can save you." While Job is questioning God's justice, God in turn tells Job, "I am perfectly just, far better than your own judgment." God seems to be saying, "My justice will come. Maybe not now, maybe not soon, but it will come. I will correct every wrong. I will dry away every tear. I will punish every wrongdoing. I will defeat the wicked. I will overcome evil with good. That's the justice of God coming. And God is telling Job, you trust that I am just. You wait for my justice. But for the meantime, you have to trust me. You have to trust that I know better than you. For us, that means we ought to humble ourselves and trust that God's justice is perfect, even though we don't understand it, we don't like it, and it doesn't fit to our own versions of justice. I think that's the invitation of faith. As one song says, God is too wise to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So if you don't understand, if you cannot see His hand, and if you cannot see His plan, you just have to trust His heart. The heart of God is good. The heart of God is righteous. The heart of God is loving. The heart of God is just. He will bring justice. Maybe not now, not yet, not soon, but He will do it. For the meantime, we wait. For the meantime, we hope. For the meantime, we trust. Do you think the world is unfair, full of injustice? Have you been wronged? Was a crime committed against you? You feel like there is no justice in the wounds, in the hurts, in the betrayal, and the violations committed against you? You have to trust that God's slow but sure work of justice will come. He will avenge us. He will avenge you. Do not take matters into your own hands. Do not entertain the temptation that you can do better than God, that you can run your life and run the world better than how God does it. That's faith. Faith is the confidence that God is doing what He thinks is best out of His love, out of His goodness, out of His justice. We endure pain, not because of an explanation of why we suffer, but through an encounter with who God is. So back to the question of suffering. Why is there suffering in the world? Why do people suffer? Whether it's from earthquakes or wild animals or from crime against other human beings. Well, God's response is, the world is complex. The universe is so huge and complicated, and there are things that are happening that we cannot totally understand. But we can trust Him. We can trust that He manages the universe well, and He runs the world based on His goodness, based on His love, based on His wisdom, based on His power, and based on His justice. That's God's response to Job's inquiries about the suffering he's going through. So the book of Job is not really an explanation of why people suffer. It's not a story of reasons why suffering happens in this world or in our lives. But rather, the book of Job is an invitation to understand that the way we handle suffering, the way we endure pain, and the way we encounter what the difficulties and the problems in our lives is through our knowledge of who God is. More often, it's not an explanation about why we suffer that really matters most, but rather an encounter with the goodness of God, an encounter with the justice of God, an encounter with the wisdom of God, an encounter with who God is. Like Job, the book also invites us to honestly bring to God all our complaints, our grievances, and to humbly come to Him and cast all our cares to Him. Because He cares for us. And we can bring to Him our pain and our grief and our burdens. Because we can trust that He cares. Because we trust that He knows what He's doing. Because we can trust that He who began a good work in us is faithful to finish what He began. And we can also trust that God is causing all things to work together for our good. That's the story of Job. It's a story of faith. It's a story of faith amidst our suffering. So what is God saying to Job? God is saying, I am infinitely wise, far beyond your comprehension. I am all-powerful, far greater than your capacity. I am perfectly just, far better than your judgment. Let us pray. Father, I thank you that you are good, you are faithful, you are wise, you are powerful, and you are just. Lord, I pray for all of us who are going through difficult times. I pray for all of us who are going through suffering and pain and evil and injustice in this world. Lord, teach us to see that you are bigger, Lord, than any problem that we go through. To help us to see that you are larger than any injustice that we suffer. I pray that you will allow us to understand more and more of you. And the more we know who you are, Lord, I pray that we will endure. Lord, I pray that your peace, your joy, your strength, and your presence will guide us, will see us through. Thank you, Lord. We love you, we honor you today, and we praise you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.